Not a single tutorial on this channel showcases movement in relation to a camera. It's become one of the most frequently asked questions in the YouTube comments and in the channel Discord. That changes today. In this video, you will learn everything that you need to know about moving your character relative to a camera's perspective, and hopefully understand how it all works. My name is Nikki, this channel is iHeartGameDev, and now, let's get started. To move any game object relative to the camera, we can multiply the player's forward and backward input from a controller or keyboard by the camera's normalized forward directional vector. We will do the same for the left and right input with the camera's normalized right directional vector. And then we add these two resulting vectors together and apply it to the character, noting that because this vector's values are in world space, we'll need to be sure that the method of movement that we are using is also relative to world space. Oh, and if we are only trying to move relative to the camera's X and Z axes, we'll need to first remove the Y axis values of the forward and right vectors and renormalize them so that our character doesn't start flying away. And that's it. What? What on earth does all this mean? If you're like me, you want to understand the code we are writing. So, let's break all this down and start with the absolute basics. In math, we can use vectors to describe movement. Vectors are typically visualized as a line with an arrow at one end. The length of the line is the vector's magnitude, and the arrow represents the vector's direction. A vector consists of two points, the head and the tail. The head designating the placement of the arrow and signifies which direction the vector is pointed. Now, when programming in Unity, movement in 3D space is defined and performed using a type called a vector 3. A vector 3, once again, has a direction and a magnitude which are calculated from the head and the tail. However, each point is in 3D space, and is therefore made up of three numbers, one per axis, x, y, and z. When instantiating a new vector 3, the tail of the vector 3 will always be at 0 on the x, y, and z axes, while the head can be at any location in 3D space. A vector 3's direction can then be calculated from the angles generated from all three axes to the vector. Now, direction is a key term to understand here. All movement has direction, and in Unity, positive movement on the z-axis is considered forward movement. Positive movement on the y-axis is considered upward movement, and positive movement on the x-axis is considered rightward movement. Each of these can be represented by what's known as a unit vector. A unit vector is a normalized vector, and that means its magnitude, or total length, is 1. With our new understanding of each direction in Unity and its associated axis, forward z, up y, and right x, the unit vector for the forward direction is 0x, 0y, and 1z. The unit vector for up is 0x, 1y, 0z. And the unit vector for right is 1x, 0y, and 0z. Let's pause and take a look at the original code with our new knowledge. We now understand that a vector is a direction and a magnitude, and vector 3 is Unity's type for vectors in 3D space. We are getting and storing two vector 3s, the camera's transform forward vector and camera's transform right vector. According to Unity's documentation, these are both normalized vectors, meaning they are both what we now understand to be unit vectors, aka they have a length of 1. What's interesting though, is that if we log the value of these vector 3s, we might expect the forward value to be 0x, 0y, 1z, and 1x, 0y, 0z for the right. But this is only the case if the camera isn't rotated. Why? Let's continue our learning. When it comes to moving game objects in 3D space, there are many possible ways that it can be programmed in Unity. We can use the built-in transform.translate method. We can also update the transform's position directly. We can use UND's built-in character controller and its move method as we have been in the series on this channel. And we can move using physics with the add force, add relative force, and move position methods, or directly setting the velocity of a rigid body component. All of these options either apply a Vector 3 to the game object, or they are a Vector 3 attribute of the game object, which we are then overriding. While the use of some of these is a better practice than others, and I may have even missed some alternatives, a key aspect when using any method to move a game object is to understand the space or the coordinate space in which they operate. There are two spaces in which a game object can move through Unity's coordinate system using Vector 3s. World space and local space. World space is a static coordinate system, static meaning constant or unchanging. In world space, the direction of the X, Y, and Z axes will never change. If we were to apply a transformation to the position of a game object relative to world space, the game object would always move along these constant X, Y, and Z axes. On the contrary, applying transform values relative to local space applies movement to the local coordinate system. While the static and unchanging world space stands as the source of truth in Unity because it doesn't change, local space is variable and is based on the rotation of the game object relative to the world's default rotation. It's this rotation that determines the forward, up, and right directions and the axes in local space. Both are viable options for character movement. And it's worth pointing out that these two spaces are easily demonstrable with a local and global toggle in the Unity editor. And for a real-world example, it's like how north, south, east, and west are always the same direction, regardless of whatever direction you are facing. We might consider the world space forward direction to be north, but if we are rotated, our local forward direction might actually be southeast relative to world space. So to refine our understanding of directions and bring back the earlier question of why the camera's transform forward vector may not be 0x, 0y, and 1z. Forward in Unity's world space can always be represented by the 0x, 0y, and 1z unit vector. And a game object's transform forward unit vector in local space will also state that it's 0x, 0y, 1z. However, and this is a key point to understand, spaces are convertible. A forward unit vector of 0x, 0y, 1z in local space may not be the same when converted to world space. It could be something like 0.6x minus 0.5y minus 0.6z in world space instead, and that's going to be dependent on the game object's rotation. So, we now understand the first two lines in this camera-based movement code provide the normalized direction vectors of our camera, which are the directions we want our character to move. And we can understand that camera.main.transform.forward is the camera's forward vector 3 that has values relative to world space, which is why it isn't guaranteed to be 0x, 0y, and 1z as we might have expected. But relative to local space, it would be. And the world forward vector relative to local space might be something different. Let's talk about movement. Whether we are using the new or old input system, we typically need to get and store the horizontal and vertical input of the controller sticks, D-pad, or WASD. Without considering camera-based movement, we normally get these input values, create a new vector 3, and assign the vertical input to the Z value and the horizontal input for the X value. The Y value is withheld for jumping and gravity. This new vector 3 is then passed as an argument to one of the movement methods mentioned earlier. As explained, each method operates relative to either the world or local coordinate spaces. Pushing forward on the stick will either move the game object on the world Z axis or the local Z axis. Okay, back to the original code. We have the user's input stored, which is normally passed to our movement methods. We understand what vectors and space are. And we have the directional unit vectors of the camera, whose values are relative to world space. These next lines that we'll break down are the key to camera-based movement. We multiply the forward camera vector by the vertical input value, the right camera vector by the horizontal input value, and add these products together to create a new vector 3. What is happening here? Vectors are rotatable, or in other words, transferable. If we have two coordinate spaces and a vector set in one coordinate space, we can transform that vector from the current coordinate space to the other one. What this means is that the angles generated from each axis to that vector in the original coordinate space would have a comparable angle for the new vector and axes in the coordinate space it was transformed to. But how does this rotation work? The answer is math. If we have the normalized forward and right vectors of a new coordinate space, whose values are relative to, or have been converted to, the coordinate space that the vector we are trying to rotate is currently in, we can then multiply each directional unit vector by its corresponding axis value, forward z and right x, by then adding the products together, we create a new vector. And this resulting vector will have the same angle to the new coordinate space that the original vector has to the original coordinate space. The values will still be in the original coordinate space, but if converted to the new coordinate space, they are actually the original values. Pretty cool. As an example, let's assume that we have two coordinate spaces. One coordinate space has a 90-degree difference from the other. If the point we are trying to rotate is located at 0x, 0y, 5z, and we note that the forward unit vector of the new coordinate space is 1x, 0y, 0z when converted to the current space, and the right unit vector is 0x, 0y, minus 1z, we can multiply this forward unit vector by the z value of 5 to get 5x, 0y, and 0z, and multiply the right unit vector by the x value of 0 to get 0x, 0y, 0z. Adding these two products together, and we get a vector 3 with a value of 5x, 0y, 0z. So this new value relative to the original coordinate system is 5x, 0y, 0z. And relative to the new coordinate system is 0x, 0y, 5z. Just like it was in the original coordinate system. Looking back at our original code, we can understand that by multiplying the vertical input value by the camera's forward vector, and the horizontal input value by the camera's right vector, and add these products together, we successfully rotate the original player input movement vector. This result now retains the same angle relative to the camera's coordinate space. This was my simplified explanation, but for a deeper understanding of the math, I highly recommend the amazing videos on the subject by Freya, specifically rotating vectors. I've personally watched this video a dozen times in an attempt to grasp this vector math, and highly recommend checking it out yourself if you are interested. Testing this in play mode using transform.translate and the space.world enumerator. Success! The game object moves relative to the angle of our camera. But why did we need to specify space.world? Let's remember that the values returned from the camera's forward and right unit vectors are in world space. If we remove space.world and try to move, the game object no longer moves in the direction the camera is facing. This is a key point to remember. If we are to use a method of movement that uses local space when attempting to move relative to the camera's perspective, we first need to convert the forward and right camera unit vectors to that local coordinate space. This can be done with one of Unity's built-in transform methods, inverse transform vector. Now, if we attempt to move in local space, we'll see that the character correctly moves relative to the camera's direction. Let me point out that the result of this method is impacted by the scale of the game object. For example, if the game object is scaled by a factor of 2, the result of the inverse transform vector might be half the size. This is easily solved by normalizing the result to ensure that it's a proper unit vector. Okay, there's one final piece to the original logic we haven't touched yet. What happens when the camera angles up or down? Let's test it out. The game object appears to move at the exact angle as the camera, which includes upward or downward movement. This makes sense. If we draw the forward vector of the camera and log the values of the camera's forward vector, it's clear that moving forward will include y-axis movement. Let's get rid of it. We'll set the forward and right y values to 0. Now when we move, the game object correctly moves in the direction the camera is facing, but avoids movement on the y-axis. But one last question to answer is why we normalize this value. To demonstrate, if we tilt the camera at a very sharp angle up or down, we'll see that our game object moves incredibly slow. Remember, the forward and right camera vectors are already normalized, meaning it's a total length of 1. If we remove the y value, then the length of the vector becomes 1 minus y. And the resulting movement vector from the products is smaller. By removing the y values and normalizing the values again, we once again have unit vectors. For one final breakdown of the original code, we get and store the player vertical and horizontal input, which is intended to move the player forward and backward, left and right. We store the transform forward and right unit vectors of the camera, whose values are in world space. We remove the y values of both stored vectors and normalize them to ignore upward and downward camera angles. And finally, we multiply the stored forward vector by the vertical input, the right vector by the horizontal input, and add these products together to create a camera relative movement vector. Because this vector is in world space, it will be passed to a movement method that moves relative to world space. Otherwise, we'll have to do the conversion we mentioned earlier for local space. And now, we have camera relative movement. Awesome job! The next step in this series is to take a look at Cine Machine's free look camera. And soon enough, we'll be learning from the best once again, replicating the amazing camera controls of Super Mario. Thank you to all the current patrons for selecting this video's topic and for the general support. For access to project files and voting on future tutorials while supporting the channel, be sure to check out the Patreon yourself. But the biggest thank you to Zach Gettier, OneBeach, Osman Zorda, and Ruben Cueto for the top tier support. If you are interested in joining an awesome growing community of developers just like yourself, we'd love to have you in the channel Discord. For updates on the next video, feel free to follow me on Twitter. But that is all for today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.